Hello, my name is Akshay Thangsale, and you're watching the recorded lecture for Introduction to Process Simulations. In this lecture, we are going to cover how to simulate a process and do convergence. By the end of this section, you should be able to convert physical units into simulation units, identify the parameters that must be defined to solve those blocks, and to draw a complete flow sheet of a process, optimize the process to meet design specifications, test the results to verify convergence, and to use simple user-defined program like Fortran or MS Excel, and link the calculator block in Aspen Plus. To develop a model, obviously we need to use some engineering judgment, whether the process, for example, if a reactor is required, what type of reactor is required, whether it's a stir tank reactor or a plug flow reactor or a packed bed reactor of a catalyst and so on, and the unit operation selections and so on. All of this has been covered in the previous chapters of this unit, where we initially converted a process description into a block flow diagram and then a block flow diagram into a process flow diagram. We pick up this chapter from those and assume that we have developed a process flow diagram, which now needs to be converted into a process simulation diagram. Once we have selected a simulation package like Aspen Plus, we need to convert the process flow diagram and choose what process simulation model to use for the equipments that are in the process flow diagram. For example, if there is a distillation column, we need to choose which type of block in Aspen Plus will be suitable to model or simulate that distillation column. We will cover that in the due course in this lecture. Then we need to solve that model, which is not trivial and can sometimes be an iterative process, where if there is a problem in convergence, then you need to figure out how to converge that problem. Then we examine the results and test the thermodynamic model to ensure that the results are valid and has got some physical meaning to it. We also introduce utility costs where required, and also material costs, so that we can determine the operating expenses or OPEX. And then of course we can save the results and analyze them at any given time later. Let's look at the blocks that we can use in Aspen Plus to simulate the physical units. If there is any mixing or splitting of streams, we can use the blocks like mixer, F-splitter, which can split one stream into two or more streams based on split fraction, flow rates, or flow of a component. Then we can also use S-splits, which divides streams into substreams. If there are separation processes like a decanter or a flash operation, then we can use a suitable separator operation in Aspen Plus. Flash 2 is a rigorous vapor liquid splitter or vapor liquid liquid splitter. In flash 2, the 2 signifies the minimum number of streams that must be coming out of the flash. So a flash 2 accepts one input and minimum 2 output, usually one vapor and one liquid stream. But as an option, another liquid stream can be added to it. However, flash 3, the way it differs is it minimum requirement is 3 streams coming out of the outlet, the vapor stream, and 2 liquid streams. So this is used when the 2 liquids are immiscible with each other and therefore form 2 separate liquid phases. A decanter is used to separate the immiscible liquids. So when there are 2 liquids in mixture and they are immiscible liquids, we can use a decanter to separate those 2 liquid phases. A separator, or SEP, uses a split fraction of every component and can be used as a shortcut method for doing mass balances for separation processes like absorption, distillation, stripping, and so on. SEP2 is a similar problem where component splits and purities can be defined, and it can accept one inlet and 2 outlet streams. Again, it can be used as a shortcut method for distillation calculation, but only for mass balances. We cannot use separator or SEP2 for distillation when we need to do energy balances or when we need to do rigorous distillation column design. Heat exchangers, there are various options to select simulation of heat exchangers. We have heater blocks, in which case the first option, which is heater, you can select heaters, coolers, condensers, or fired heaters from this option. Heat X gives you a co-current or a counter-current heat exchanger. M heat X gives you a multi-stream heat exchanger, which can be used especially in LNG or as a cold box. HX flux gives you heat transfer calculation model including a furnace. These are more rigorous ones. In this unit, typically we can just use a heater or heat X block, which is simple heat exchangers. When it comes to separation columns, there are various choices. We have covered this in mass transfer operations, which is the previous lecture. And if you want to have more detail on that, you can watch that lecture. Briefly, DSTW is a shortcut distillation method, and distill one is also a shortcut distillation method. Both of them use different types of equations or models to model the distillation. Whereas rad frac, extract, multifrac, SC frac, petrofrac, batch sep, they are all more rigorous operations. Rad frac is a rigorous two-phase or three-phase problem, where you can do distillation, gas absorption, stripping, etc. Whereas extract is liquid-liquid extraction, and the others are for more specialized operations for petrochemical industry or for other industries, which we won't go into too much detail in this unit. To model reactors, there are again several choices to simulate that in Aspen Plus. The first three, R stoic, R yield, R equilibrium, in fact fourth, R Gibbs, are simple models, and kinetics are not included in this, whereas RCSTR, R plug, and R batch require kinetic information. Let's go through that in some detail. So R stoic requires fractional conversion or extent of reaction. So you need to know the stoichiometry of the reaction, and you need to provide fractional conversion of that reaction, or at least one component in that. R yield, you need to specify the stoichiometry of the reaction, but it does not require the atom balances in R yield. It will do calculation based on the yield distribution of the product coming out of the reactor. R equal is a rigorous equilibrium model, which uses Gibbs free energy minimization on user specified reactions. R Gibbs, on the other hand, will model all reactions possible and will use Gibbs free energy minimization to solve for those reactions, including multiphase reactions, whereas R equilibrium will solve for equilibrium of a specified reaction. RCSTR is a continuous stirred tank reactor, and you can use RCSTR to solve for the required volume of a reactor for calculating design type problems. R plug uses a plug flow reactor, which needs to be specified with the length and diameter of the tube, and you can include catalyst in R plug model as well and do catalytic kinetic models. R batch is a batch reactor, and in this case you can specify the cycle time, which means the residence time in which the reaction is taking place. Okay, so when we choose RCSTR, R plug, and R batch, they all require reaction sets to be included, which is separate to the block. You will find reactor blocks, and you can include various reactions in one reaction set, and then call that reaction set inside the reactor block. And all these reaction sets will have rate expressions for those reactions. The rate expressions could be homogeneous rate expressions or could be heterogeneous catalytic rate expressions. We will not go into too much detail in this lecture, but we can practice that in the later sessions. We will not be going into too much detail of the kinetic models because you will be learning kinetics of reactions in third year. To have pressure change operations like pumping or compressor or turbines, we can use the following operations. Pumps are used for liquids and compressors are used for gases. So that's the only difference between the two, but they both change the pressure of the stream, usually go from low pressure to higher pressure. A compressor model can also model the reverse of the operation. So instead of going from low pressure to high pressure, you can model going from high to low pressure, and you can select what is called as turbine inside the compressor block or compral block. M-compral is a multi-stage compressor in which you can specify how many compressors are there in each stage, and they will be interstage cooling. This is normally used when the ratio between the inlet pressure and the outlet pressure is very large, and a single compressor cannot handle that kind of pressure changes. We will cover that in the worked example that I'm going to show you soon. Valves are there to change the flows or to change the pressure. Pipes, on the other hand, are introduced to show the pressure drop across the length of the pipe. So the pipes are included in the process flow diagram or the process simulation diagram only when we are trying to simulate a very long pipeline which will have significant pressure drop. A pipeline is similar to pipe model, except a pipeline will have several segments of pipe, and you can model either constant diameter of each segment or changing diameter of each segment in the pipeline. Then there are several manipulators which are used for calculations. So you can have like a calculator block, a design specification block, and so on, which we are not going to cover into too much detail in this lecture, but in the subsequent lectures we will have a brief look at it. Likewise, we have solid and multiple choices like crystallizers, crusher, cyclone, filter, and so on, and solid separators like cyclone, V-scrub, C-scrub, C-fuge, and electrostatic precipitator, ESPs. Again, we are not going to too much detail of solid handling because most of the simple problems are based on gas and liquid, and solid operations are limited to practical problems where we learn only when we need to do it. You can also include some user models, so you can define your own blocks, and you can use programs like Fortran, which is a programming language and can then be included into the Aspen Plus simulation. Now we look at a work problem. In this case, we are going to look at ammonia synthesis. And just to show you briefly the process flow diagram that we are going to develop, the feed stream is stream number one, which is sent to a multi-compressor. The reason, again, we use multi-compressor is because of the pressure change. As you can see, the feed is at 300 psi absolute, and it needs to go to 4000 psi absolute, which is about 13 times. So that's a very large pressure gradient, and a single compressor will not be able to handle that pressure gradient. Followed by this, it's mixed with a recycle stream, which we are going to talk about in a minute. The mixed stream goes to a heater where the temperature is changed from 80 degrees Fahrenheit to 900 degrees Fahrenheit. And following that, we have a reactor in which the reaction takes place. So hydrogen will react with nitrogen to produce ammonia. In this case, carbon dioxide is an inert molecule. The pressure drop across the reactor is given as 30 psi. Normally, ammonia synthesis is done in a catalytic reactor, but in this case, we are going to use an equilibrium reactor, which means we are assuming that there is sufficient catalyst provided for the reaction to take place and reach equilibrium conversion. And therefore, because of that catalyst bed, we are going to have some pressure drop, and in this case, the pressure drop defined to us is 30 psi. After the reaction, ammonia needs to be separated from the nitrogen and hydrogen, which is not converted. And so to do that, temperature is reduced back to 80 Fahrenheit in a cooler. And then the vapor liquid equilibrium mixture is sent to a flash where the liquid is separated and ammonia is drawn as a product, as a liquid. And the remaining gases are sent to a splitter where some of it, 0.01% to be specific, is purged so that carbon dioxide can leave in the purge stream. And then we have a compressor which compresses the gases back to 4000 psi, because the two streams coming in the mixer must have same pressure. So let's have a look on Aspen Plus simulation. So to start our simulation, we open a new file. And once again, I'm going to open the file from an existing template that I've recently used. So I'm going to use English units because we have flow rates given in pound and temperatures and pressure given in American units as well. So we enter all the components, nitrogen, hydrogen, ammonia, and carbon dioxide, and just check the method, which is NRTL, which is from the template, and I'm satisfied with that method for this problem. So after we have entered the required information in the properties methods, we're going to start our simulation. And the first block in the process flow diagram was a multi-compressor, M-comp, followed by a mixer. The mixed stream is then sent to a heater. Because we have both heater and cooler, I'm just going to use a different block icon, but they do the same function. Then we have a Gibbs reactor, followed by a cooler. This time I'm just going to use a different icon to show the cooler. And then we have a flash separator, which separates the two phases, and therefore we have only flash 2. We don't need to use flash 3 because we don't have liquid-liquid mixture. The gas phase is then going to be split into purge and the recycle stream. And the recycle stream is then going to be compressed. So we're going to include a single stage compressor in this case, which is Comp R model. We can rotate these icons as required to make it look more organized. And we can then relabel the blocks as we need. You can leave the default names if you want. And you can also change the way this is relabeled. So in the setup of the flow sheet, you can set your defaults, whether you want to give automatic names, like in this case, it was given automatic names, B1 to B6, B8. Or you can set up your flow sheet so that every time you add a new block, it will ask you to give a name for it. But that's your personal choice. Okay, once we have relabeled all the blocks, we can start adding the streams. As you can see, as soon as I click on the material stream, it shows me the red arrows, which are the minimum required information or minimum required connections for each block. So once we connect from left to right, we have a choice of either limiting ourselves to single pass, that is not to connect the recycle stream, but having done this problem a few times, I know that the single pass or a recycle stream does not make a huge difference in solving this problem. So I'm going to connect the recycle stream back to the mixer, and it should be able to give you the same answer as the single pass conversion should have given you. Now we enter all the stream information. So minimum required stream information for the input feed is temperature, pressure, and the flow rates. So we enter all that information, which was given in the process flow diagram before. Then we need to define our blocks. So we define the number of stages. Here I've chosen a two-stage compressor. If you want, you can go for higher, but normally because the ratio of each compressor will be about 3.6, it should be fine. The interstage cooler, I'm going to select after stage 1 the outlet temperature to be the same as the inlet temperature, which is 80 degrees Fahrenheit. Then I'm going to define the heater block. So the outlet temperature that we want for heater block is 900 degrees Fahrenheit. So we enter 900. And for pressure, I'm just going to enter 0. If we enter 0, it means it's a 0 pressure drop. If I enter anything above 0, it means it is the discharge pressure. Now for the R. Gibbs reactor, we are going to include heat duty and the pressure. The pressure drop given to us is minus 30 or 30 bar pressure or 30 psi pressure drop. So I'm going to enter as minus 30, and because it's an adiabatic reactor, the heat duty is 0. and we check that the Gibbs will our Gibbs we consider all the products coming out of the equilibrium. Then we can enter the specifications for cooler. Again, the minimum required information is temperature and pressure, so we enter 80 and 0 for zero pressure drop. And finally, we're going to specify the flash where the temperature is the same, 80 degrees Fahrenheit, and pressure I'm going to say 0 for zero pressure drop. For the splitter, we're going to specify the split ratio, and we know for the purge stream, which is S9, the purge ratio was 0.01% or 0.0001 fraction. And the last block is compressor, which make sure that you select the compressor here, not the turbine. And we select isentropic compressor with a discharge pressure of 4000 psia, which should be the pressure of the mixer as well. So now our our flow sheet is completely specified. We have defined all the minimum input parameters for all the blocks, and therefore the status here shows required input complete, so we can run this simulation. And after a few iterations, you can see the simulation shows an error, and the error is in the compressor block and the solver block. Now the solver block is created by default by Aspen Plus to solve the recycle loop in the in iterative solution. And you can see the error is coming from the compressor, which says the block comp is not in mass balance. The inlet flow is given as 0.1712 plus 1, and the outlet is out by a few. It's not, the relative difference is 0.105 10 to minus 2, which is bigger than the tolerance that we have given, that Aspen has chosen by default. And therefore, the error is in the convergence block solver 1, which the Aspen Plus created itself. And the solver 1 is solving the mixer first, followed by heater, reactor, cooler, flash, split, and the last block is the compressor. And after solving all these blocks, when it comes to compressor, the mass balance does not converge after a few iterations. So therefore, it's giving us an error. The default number of iterations is 30. So let's see how we can get rid of this convergence problem. But before that, we can we have to learn how to adjust those convergence parameters. Just a reminder that the flow sheet, when there is a recycle loop or a design specification or an optimization problem, Aspen Plus uses an iterative solution, especially in the sequential modeler approach. When we go to the equation-oriented modeler mode, then it will solve in a single operation with simultaneous equation problem. But by default, Aspen will solve all the flow sheets in a sequential modeler mode. So when there is a recycle loop, Aspen will choose a tear stream by default. A tear stream is a recycle stream in which the component flow, the total flow, pressure, and enthalpy are all determined iteratively. And it can be any stream in the loop, which is default chosen by the Aspen Plus. There's also a convergence block created by Aspen Plus for all problems where a tear stream is needed, or design specification is needed, or optimization problem is given. A convergence block, like the solver block we saw earlier, is determined by first guess to a tear stream and then solving iteratively, or it can give a guess value for a design specification variable and then change that iteratively. And it monitors the value of the assumed parameter against the true parameter after each iteration. And the value is set to be converged when the assumed value matches with the actual value after all the calculation in that iteration. The sequence of the iteration is also determined by default. Normally it's from left to right, as we saw in the problem that I showed earlier. And it includes all the unit operations that are in that convergence block. So we saw the convergence block was solver 1, and it had mixer, followed by heater, then the reactor, cooler, the flash and the splitter and then the compressor. If we want, we can give our user-defined convergence options. To change the convergence parameter or method of a convergence block, we can go to convergence options. To select the trace stream, we can go to the trace stream options. For some or all of the convergence block needed, we can specify the convergence block itself by going into the convergence option in the form. And to change the convergence order for some or all user-defined convergence block, we can go to the convergence order form. To change the sequence of the simulation, we can go to the sequence form in Aspen Plus. In the convergence block, we have several options that we can specify. We can give the convergence tolerance value for the trace stream, and that by default is 0.0001. If we want, we can lower that tolerance value to make our stream converge. The convergence method can be specified for the trace stream design specification or optimization problem. So in this case, because we don't have any design specification or optimization problem, the convergence method is only applicable for the trace stream. We can also affect the parameters that affect the sequencing. We can change those parameters as required, or we can change the convergence parameter for each method. Let's have a look at those in greater detail. So the tear convergence tolerance is a tear stream convergence value, which it calculates on the, it assumes a value first, and then it calculates the value after the iteration, and then the difference between the calculated value and the assumed value divided by the assumed value must be within the tolerance limit. So minus tolerance to plus tolerance. It must be equal to or between those values. By default, the trace options is cut off in the convergence options. So if you go to convergence options defaults and take convergence sheet, you will see that the default option is cut off. And when this option is selected, Aspen Plus will bypass the convergence test for all components which have trace amounts of value. So the trace value could be mole flow rate or mole fraction or enthalpy and so on. The normal default value of the trace threshold is the tolerance value divided by 100. The alternative trace option is called as trace the gradual, and it adds 100 times the trace threshold term to the denominator. And this setting gradually relaxes the convergence test for the trace components. So let's see if we can adjust the tolerance value to make this flow sheet converge. So last time when we were solving it, we saw the error in the block comp or compressor block where the relative mass difference was 0.110 to minus 2. And check again that the solver is solving in that sequence. So we are just using the default sequence. Now if we go to the convergence block, and then open options, and then go to the default options, we can change those defaults here. So as you can see, the tolerance default is 0.0001, and the trace option is cut off, and it's measuring both pressure and enthalpy, and the default method is Weckstein. So let's first change the tolerance value so that we can try and make this flow sheet converge. So I've lowered by an order of magnitude, and we still get an error. If I lower the tolerance further, and this time it's two orders of magnitude relaxed value, the flow sheet is converged, but it gives a value. So let's have a look what this problem is. It shows that the following unit operation completed with warning. So the problematic block here is still the compressor block. So if you go to control panel, and if we scroll up, we should be able to read what the warning is. It says the block comp is not in mass balance, and it gives a relative difference of 0.8 into minus 3. So the imbalance, it says, is due to loose tear tolerance of stream 11, which is the tear stream. So even though we are able to solve it and the relative difference is quite small, if we choose to, we can ignore this warning and continue with our simulation. Or if you want a more tighter value and try and converge the mass balance without getting the warning, then we need to do something else. The other option for us to make the flow sheet converge is to change the convergence method. By default, the tear stream uses Weckstein method for conversion. It uses a tear convergence block, and we can have other options for that tear stream. It can have a direct conversion method, Broyden conversion method, or Newton conversion method. So in this flow sheet, we have to only adjust the tear stream default method. But if there are other problems where you have a single design specification, we might be able to change the default method for that option. So for single design spec, the default option is secant, and other options are Broyden and Newton. For multiple design specifications, the default option is Broyden, but we have an option to use Newton as well. And when there are tear streams and design specification, the default option is Broyden and the other option is Newton. When we have optimization problem, then the default option is SQP, and we can try and choose other design optimization convergence blocks, which are user-defined convergence block. Let's look at the default method and the other methods for tear stream. The default method for tear stream is Weckstein, which is the quickest and the most reliable method to solve a convergence problem, and which is why it has been chosen as the default. It uses extrapolation of the direct substitution method by iteration. So the direct method is given below. This is an extrapolation of the direct method. The interaction between variables are ignored here, which is why it's so quick. And it works very strongly only when the variables are not coupled. Okay, so in other words, it does not work well when the variables are strongly coupled. It uses a lower bound of -5 and upper bound of 0. The direct method is similar to Weckstein method, except it will have a new value for a tear stream value, which is resulting from the previous flow sheet calculation pass. And then basically it's substituting in each iteration, it's substituting the previous iteration's calculation, which we have looked at in Excel in a recycle mass balance problem in a previous lecture. We can use the direct method in those rare cases when Weckstein is not able to converge the problem. It's also easy in default method, in the direct method rather, to identify the convergence problem, such as if there is any component buildup in the system. It's equivalent to Weckstein, except the lower bound is 0 instead of -5. The Broyden method is a more rigorous method because it uses a quasi-Newton method, which is a non-linear non-linear model to converge the problem, but it's faster than Newton method. But because of the modification to the Newton method, it's often not as reliable as the Newton method. It's useful. The Broyden method is useful for multiple tear streams or design specifications. So in our problem, the ammonia synthesis problem, we only had one tear stream and no design specification. So we should have got an answer with either the Weckstein method or the direct method. Obviously the Weckstein method did not work, but maybe the direct method might work. But if it does not work, then it's possible that the tear stream variables are interdependent. Because there is a reaction happening, the fraction of ammonia in the recycle loop depends upon the mole fractions of ammonia, so mole fractions of nitrogen and hydrogen entering into the reactor. So it's trying to solve iteratively the reaction conversion, and depending upon that, the flows of ammonia and other components. So because of that interdependency, it may not be able to converge that stream. Newton method is the most rigorous method because it implements a modified Newton method for simultaneous nonlinear equation solution. It's useful when recycle loops or design specifications are highly interrelated and when the convergence is not achieved using Broyden method. Obviously, this method is going to be slower than all other methods that we have looked at because it is using nonlinear simultaneous equation solution. Therefore, when using Newton method, it should be used when the number of components are relatively small and all other methods have failed to achieve the convergence. So in other words, we try and limit the Newton method only to problems where none of the other methods have worked to converge the problem. It's just to avoid computationally heavy calculations. So let's have a look again. Last time we had a look, the compressor was not in mass balance. The relative difference and the tolerances are given here. So we go back and go to the tolerance that was given us by default, which is 0.001, and then change the default method for the test stream. After Weckstein method, we can try the direct method, which is slower, but still not as rigorous as direct, not as rigorous as Newton or Broyden. So we reset the simulation and then run it again. We still come up with errors. We can try and identify what that error is, and you can see again the compressor block has some errors and the solver block has some errors. Obviously the compressor block is inside the solver block, so if compressor block is showing an error, thus the convergence block will also show an error. Once again, the error is because that a compressor is not in mass balance, and you can see the relative difference is this time 0.5 10 to minus 2. And if we have to make this converge, we have to again go back to our method of convergence and see if other methods work better. So we can try a Broyden method next because it is faster than Newton method. Again, we reinitialize so that we're not using wrong values to initiate our simulation. And once again, we come up with an error. And if you look this time, the solver is in error. Compressor is solving fine. So the error says convergence block solver not converged in 30 iterations, three variables not converged, and maximum tolerance or maximum error is minus 3.99 10 to 2. And as you can go scroll up and you can have a look at all the iterations if you want and see what variable is giving the problem. So if none of the other methods have worked, then we must try the Newton method. Again, we reinitiate the problem and then solve using run. Just check the tear tolerance value is the same. This time the simulation is able to converge and we should be able to see the solution. As you can see, there's still one warning generated for physical properties, but the simulation is solving fine. We'll come back to the physical properties warning in the next lecture, but let's recap and see the solution for this. So it has taken 26 passes using Newton method to converge the tear stream, which is S11. And you can see the results in the stream summary. If you scroll down, you can see the flow rate for each of those streams and analyze the results using this stream table. So I'm going to conclude this lecture here, and in the next lecture we are going to focus on analyzing the results, and we'll check how that warning in the properties method can be avoided. So just to recap, to converge a flow sheet, we need to check what the tear stream value is, what the tolerance is, and the sequence of iteration. After reviewing the tolerance and the sequence, we can adjust those parameters, or we can adjust the convergence method to solve the flow sheet. So this is all for now, and I hope to see you in the tutorials. Bye for now.